You're listening to Dallas Theological Seminary's Chapel Podcast, a clear voice in chaotic times.
Welcome to Friday Chapel. I hope you've had a good week so far and are looking forward to an enjoyable weekend. Time to catch up on the reading you didn't get done this week, or prepare for next week, or just hang out with some friends and family and have a great time. I want to remind you that next week is the Nathan Meyer Memorial Series in Bible Exposition, and our speaker next week is Dr. Lon Solomon, senior pastor of McLean Bible Church in a Virginia suburb of Washington, D.C., and he'll be coming next week to share our chapel time with us, and he's speaking on modern theological myths next week. This is the first of four conferences that we have during chapel time in the academic year, and as four chapel periods in which we extend chapel till 11:25. Today, we're having a faculty forum, and this is an opportunity for various faculty members to come and discuss various current and critical contemporary issues in a context in which they talk about it from biblically and theologically informed thinking. And we want this to be a good time for us to have some interaction as a seminary family. I'd like to think of it four objectives for our faculty forum. Four words that begin with I. First one is informal. We want this to be a thoughtful dialogue. It's not scripted. It'll sort of be the faculty unplugged, if I could say it that way. Second, we want it to be interesting. Topics of broad interest to DTS students who are preparing for Christian ministry in a pluralistic, syncretistic world. We want it to be informative, expanding your awareness and understanding of critical issues. And we want it to be interactive. We want to give you an opportunity to ask questions, and so approximately halfway through our time, we will give you an opportunity to walk to one of the microphones in each of the aisles and ask a question of our panel. And we want you to be clear and crisp, no bloviating, as a TV commentator says. We want this to be a good time for you to have some interaction with the faculty. So at this time, I'd like to turn the rest of our chapel time over to our moderator, Bob Pine, professor of theological studies, and he'll introduce our panel and our topic for today. Bob?
Thank you, John. We have four of us here with microphones, and we thought about doing a little song as a quartet, but entertainment does not begin with an I, so we'll not do that. Anyway, we have here John Hanna, who is distinguished professor. Is it distinguished or senior, or senior distinguished, or
extinguished,
has been around a while and is just really impressive professor of historical theology. We have Dr. Glenn Kreider, who is professor of theological studies, along with Dr. Scott Harrell and me. These three all participated on Monday in a seminar titled Trends and Traps in Contemporary Theology. And so I wanted to begin by asking each of them to give us a short, put those notes away, a short synopsis of what they had to say. So a two-minute takeaway, 2 minutes each. What did you talk about? What did you want people to walk away with after hearing you speak on these contemporary theological topics on Monday? And John, we'll start with you.
I think if I summarized what I tried to say, I think I had I could state my thesis two ways. One, American evangelicalism is a movement in cultural decline because it has increasingly defended itself more culturally than biblically. Or second, that American evangelicalism is becoming yesterday's liberalism,
particularly the 1890s variety, meaning enculturation. So having stated that thesis, I tried to argue the causes. And for me, the causes were things like our interaction and reaction to liberalism has forced us away from the meta-narrative of Scripture to a more individualized text-based approach to Scripture. That the American civil body politic has influenced us, the pragmatism, the individualism, the quest for numbers, personality, things like that. The Enlightenment has influenced us and forced us unwittingly into a rational approach, almost exclusively rational approach to truth. The loss of common grace in our culture. And so I stated a thesis, I argued a cause, I postulated some remedies. Among them, I argued that preaching should become more focused on the great meta-narrative of Holy Scripture, meaning Christ. And if you look at our Article 1 of our doctrinal statement, it says that no passage of Scripture is truly understood until you understand it as pointing in some way to the Savior. Second, I argued that we need to return to pastoral care as a focal point of pastoral ministry. I suggested that we need to set aside the penit for growth and the penit to determine value by the size of your church rather than by the heart of your church. I suggested that we have to begin again to take seriously the educational decline in the laity and address that issue among God's people. And then I concluded by saying that in my theory, I think of three people that should inform our ministries. Jonathan Edwards for its theological Christocentrism, Bill Gates and Howard Schultz, founder of Starbucks, for their ability to create organizations of deep commitment, narrow purpose, and perpetuate those purposes. We could learn from those guys. And from Bill Hybels and from Rick Warren, I think we could learn something about creativity in the ministry.
Thank you. Now, as you all hear that, you're probably thinking, okay, I want that tape, right? Those CDs are available. They will be available through the Leadership Center. We do not have them for sale here, but they do have tapes of all these sessions, along with the one by Dr. Bingham, will be available through the Leadership Center, and you can contact them for that. When you talk about the grand meta-narrative, John, of Christ as the center of Scripture, the center of our message, Scott, you talked about many faces of Christ in your presentation.
Yeah, Bob. I think sometimes we need to get a feeling for how Jesus is perceived around the world and in other groups in America as well. So I did kind of the broad sweep on the many faces. I'll get to the purpose of all that in just a minute. But I began with Jesus in other religions. We're facing fairly serious polemic right now around the world of Christianity as a Western religion, and we need to understand what the Islamic person, the Muslim, is saying, or the Hindu, or the Buddhist. We need to understand more what's going on in the minds of others in animism or spiritism. And as we go out very often on short-term missions, or some of us looking at long-term, how is it that Jesus Christ is perceived in these other religions? Because almost always, in some way, they absorb him one way or another into their paradigm. Islam, for example, believes that Jesus Christ was taken before he was scourged and crucified, that Allah would never allow his prophet to suffer crucifixion, and that Jesus is coming again, not Muhammad. They believe Jesus is coming as Messiah. Just got a message from Amman yesterday. The first thing he will do is break the cross, confess Islam, and then judge the infidels, which include us. So very interesting paradigms are out there. Secondly, we looked at Jesus in global Christendom. How is he perceived sometimes quite differently from the way we do in Latin America or in Africa or in Asia. And what might be immensely valuable in what they do bring to the table? They see things that we do not, that much more compassion for the poor, I think, on the part of those influenced by a liberation theology. Sometimes they go too far in their humanizing of Jesus in the sense of almost denying his deity. But they see valuable things that we need to understand as well. Then I looked at the American Jesus or Jesuses. We looked at Mormonism, we looked at Masonry, we looked at the Jesus-only Pentecostalism, the Gnostic Jesus, which some of our other faculty have been battling quite frontally in their publications, and the postmodern Jesus, where virtually all creedalism is being let go of in the name of each experiencing Jesus as they want, your own personal Jesus. So the point of all of this really was to remind us of how we need to be centered in our Lord, much as what John is saying, with the larger schematic of Trinity behind that, and based in Scripture as our absolute, and with others from around the world, especially thinking of those Christologies from different continents of those who love the Lord, gathering around the Word of God to understand more profoundly from the Word, which is our absolute, who is this Jesus Christ, and what might others then say to us as they perceive things truly in the Bible that can enrich our understanding of the Savior.
Okay, that's another tape you're going to want to get. All right. So from Jesus to come quickly, Lord Jesus. Glenn, your focus was on eschatology.
And what I decided to do was to, because much of what I do in ST 106 is designed to answer those trends and traps. And so what I decided to do was take ST 106, remove all the U2, and I had an hour left. In which I argued what is at the very heart of my worldview is that fear and hope are mutually exclusive, that fear engenders fear and hope engenders hope, and that the use of fear to engender hope is doomed to failure because fear does not engender hope, fear engenders fear. And that biblical eschatology and Christian eschatology is a message of hope. It's a message of hope that can only be understood as it's connected to the meta-narrative of creation, fall, and recreation. And again, as our doctrinal statement says, that no portion of Scripture would go beyond that to say no divine revelation can be understood until it leads to Christ in his person and work in his first and second coming. And so in looking at the meta-narrative of Scripture, starting at the beginning, and then the fall, and the hope of a recreated heaven and earth, that the hope of all Christians is when the work of redemption is completed, when God's plan for his created order culminates, that we will together be left behind to enjoy a relationship with our Creator and Savior forever in a new earth. And that story, when it's told, when it's understood, then provides a biblical, theological, and narrative defense for a pre-trib rapture, where when we look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, we see the pattern, we see a break in the pattern, we see an inconsistency with that pattern, which provides support for that not fitting into the pattern of one of the comings of Christ in judgment, and thus provides support for our theological position. But I wanted people to walk away with a renewed hope and walk away with these words ringing in their ears: do not be afraid, do not be afraid, do not be afraid, do not be afraid, do not be afraid. How much of my 2 minutes do I have left?
Some of you might have recognized a little Derek Webb on top of the U2 there at the end. Thank you for that. When we think about trends and traps in contemporary theology, what I heard in common from all three of you was a desire to navigate our contemporary world, which we are unavoidably contemporary. It's either that or be dead, and then we'd really be irrelevant. But as we think about navigating our world, I hear all of you saying we want to make sure that the things that we say are timeless, that they're not just fads, that they're not just provincial. And so how do you do that while you yourself are obviously situated in time and place? And how do you avoid, in a sense, being restricted to your time and place theologically? How can we move toward that which is timeless and not just provincial? I'm going to ask Scott, maybe you can start us on that, and then we'll kind of go from there. And we won't all necessarily chime in on every one of them, but we'll start there.
Well, I love this school and our heritage because we put Scripture in the middle. We don't always see everything there. Sometimes we very much reinterpret it through our own grids. That's why we need others as well in church history, as we follow how Nicaea, Chalcedon, and others understood Christ and got it right. And yet, so on the one hand, we have a historic sense of who Christ is based in Scripture. On the other hand, I think one trap that we can fall into is that we might too quickly reject what perhaps another culture, those believers in that culture, are saying they also find in Scripture and is so relevant to their own reality. Kwame Badiako talks about Jesus of the deep forest for Africa and bringing that Savior that we interpret in our own metaphors into our reality in North America, doing the same within that one, yet within the bounds of Scripture and really historical orthodoxy as well. So we do, don't we? We walk between the final testimony of the Word of God and what the Church has affirmed around that, and yet sensitivity to other cultures and being open to what we can learn from them to enrich our own understanding.
I would call for a different T word, that rather than talking about timelessness, let's talk about transcendence. And I think the answer then, and that's usually what we mean by timeless, we mean that which is enduring, that which is transcendent. And that's where the eschaton is really helpful for us, because the present is interpreted and is makes sense in light of the person and work of Christ in his first and second coming. The past makes sense, the present makes sense, and the future makes sense because of that our hope is that that increasingly and finally, ultimately, the future will invade the present when the heavenly city comes down, when there's no more sorrow or pain or crying or shame, and we walk on the streets that have no name.
John, in your presentation, you talked about some of the traps that evangelicals have fallen into that has truncated our message, has kept us from that type of transcendent or timeless or ongoing message, and left us with something smaller. How do we move back toward, or in, maybe not put it in retro language, how can we move toward that which is going to outlive us?
I really think that what we have fundamentally done through the centuries is confused effect as cause. And we have labored in the validity of effects and have not emphasized the cause. It seems to me that we all want the same thing. The question becomes, how do we pursue that same thing? And there has to be a tension between the past, the non-negotiable, and the present and future flexibility. I think ultimately there is no society. That's a mistake we make I think, there are as many societies as there are existences. And therefore, you may have two churches on the same block in two different worlds. So we must train our people in the timelessness of piety and bibliocentricity, but also in creativity, because I can't help them to see the world they're going to stand in. I can speak to what is timeless, but I do not know what is temporal. They will have to figure that out. So my plea is, see the temporal as a vehicle unto an end of that which is eternal. You will not succeed, you will fail. But it's a delightful pursuit because it's right.
I want to invite you all to ask questions also. We have microphones in both aisles. And you know what? Even you faculty who are sitting out there are welcome to ask questions. It's okay. You can wear a disguise if you'd like in doing that. But you're welcome to ask questions, all of you. Just move to the microphone, and that way I'll know that you have one. And in the meantime, while maybe some of you are moving that direction, it does seem that partly what we're talking about, John, is when you say that there could be two churches on the same block that really are in different worlds, you could also have two people in the same church who are in really different worlds. And so we're pretty far from any one-size-fits-all kind of answer. I find myself moving toward a simpler center sometimes. I find myself using more creedal language to say some of the old answers are truly relevant if we ponder them, and if we ponder them well. How do you all manage thinking about the diversity, the pluralistic society in which we live, both in terms of its potential difficulty and its potential benefit when it comes to the doing of theology in ministry?
I think what it tells me is that you're right. There's not one kind of church people in any church. There's multiplicities. And the only way to speak meaningfully to them publicly is universally. The way to speak to them meaningfully privately is individually. Ergo, therefore, if we don't bring back the great art of pastoral care, we will never reach our people individually. The more distant you are from an object, the least influence, the less influence you have on it. And I personally believe that in the penit for size as validity of significance, we are in danger of hurting the very people we're trying to reach by impersonalism.
I'd like to pick up on that a little bit too, because teaching Trinitarianism, I take everything back to God. And whereas Islam is a monolithic society, there is no room for divergence, we have a God who is both one and many, that is one and three. We have a place for diversity. A beautiful part of God's creation reflects that difference, and each one of us has our place as this broadly diverse universe in which we live. And so I see that balance in God himself, and therefore, as we minister in our churches, that can spill forth in many different ways, but I think encouraging diversity around the center of belief, I think as John is saying, but the manifestation of how that works out can be really quite remarkably diverse and beautifully so.
Let's get your question.
This is for any of them, obviously. Just when looking at our culture, and we'll say ministering in this Western culture in particular, assuming history and life is cyclical, which writers and theologians do you find yourself turning back to as relevant in their time and ours?
Can I say Edwards before either of them does?
It's one of the great strengths of Edwards, is that a man who's doing theology prior to the full-blown Enlightenment, and if the pluralism in postmodernity has a great deal in common with premodernity, and I think it does, Edwards is a great resource, a great help. And my second choice would be Bono.
I too have a great appreciation for Edwards, and also for Robert Jensen, who is a more is in our day. He's late in his career as an American theologian up at Princeton, and Jensen has a book called America's Theologian, a Recommendation of Jonathan Edwards. And in it, he said that he found himself at one point knowing more about 19th century Germany than he did about American theologians. And so he taught a seminar on American systematic theologians, and he said he found many to like and one to love. And the one to love was Edwards. And his book on him says essentially that he foresaw, maybe not forecast, maybe didn't know it was coming, but he made choices in his theology that held true through the shifting sands of the next two centuries and remained relevant throughout that time. And for a contemporary university theologian to say that is indeed a high recommendation.
Dr. Bingham would also call us back to the fathers, and since he's out fishing today, somebody should speak for him.
Thank you. We have some more questions. Let's go to this side of the room.
Yeah, and the idea that we try to be culturally relevant to our people and the people that we're ministering to as a church, how do you guys feel that we as a church are doing in relation to be diverse in reaching people groups? And the issue that I see that I'm confused about is that the church is predominantly ethnically not diverse. And everywhere I see in churches, it's predominantly ethnic groups that are specified. And I'm confused as to the statement when Paul says, be all thing to all people, the idea that doesn't really cross cultural or ethnic boundaries.
Thank you. Scott, why don't you try that one?
That's a tough balance, Ryan, because people naturally congregate around those that hold their history and their beliefs and their ways of relating. And yet, of course, we're in a pluralistic society, and yet it's not so pluralistic in the church, as you're saying. But I think that's the theme that I'm hearing these others say. We have a center that is our faith in Christ and the scriptures themselves, and that should be. We have the mandate to apply that creatively to all men in different ways, and youth, as you're doing, and so many others. So we stand in that tension, don't we? And I'm not sure a local body can be all things to all men in itself. We have our focuses, and therefore we must appreciate and nurture our relationships with other churches that reach groups that we're not very good at reaching. I don't say that we shouldn't try, however, as a local church to reach all, but I think the sociological reality of it, as you look around the world, would say that we better appreciate and build up other churches that are reaching other groups that are very much like, very different from us culturally, but have the same belief set.
Over here.
What value, if any, does narratology have to the current project of epistemology, historiography regarding Jesus, and eschatology?
Okay, since I don't understand the question, I'm going to send it to Glenn.
I think John Hannah would be the perfect...
Say it again, because I didn't even hear it.
What value, if any, in evangelical theology does, say, the narrative aspect, narratology, maybe Hans Frey's work, have in our epistemology, the historiography regarding Jesus, the Jesus Project, and even eschatology. How does, what value does narrative theology have to us as evangelicals, essentially?
I don't really, you too.
Yeah. Maybe someone's smarter than I am. What was the question? No, I don't know.
Okay, thank
you. I'm all for it, but I mean, narrative theology is fine.
Thinking in theological method about narrative theology, about post-liberalism and emphasis on that, okay. And then connecting it to our eschatology and to our understanding of Jesus.
Oh, I don't know how to do all that. I mean, I just read Blue Jazz and liked it. let's see. I'm trying to say something. I got it. Okay, just took a while. Senior moment. It would seem to me that the world, some of the world in which we live, is not drinking at the well of the epistemological framework of the Enlightenment, meaning rationality, sequence. We're in a world that operates and conveys truth more by story. And I think we should take into account that. If that was your question, my own personal feeling is as I have moved away from epistolary literature because I was clubbed with it as a child, and even here at Dallas Seminary, which is fine, I mean, it's true. But I find more receptivity for the great ideas of Scripture by conveying them through the stories of the Bible rather than epistolary literature, because the modern mind seems to like story more than declaration. So I tend to go to declaration through story instead of the reverse.
And if I could summarize something that Glenn was doing in his work on Monday in the presentation, again, it's available to you on CD through the Leadership Center, he situates eschatology in a context of biblical story so that it's not a matter of here's the proof text, but here's the grand story. And I hear you also saying, John, about a biblical meta-narrative, that you're not interested in defending grand-scale societal meta-narratives, but that there is a Christian one that is a worthwhile story to share.
I think what's important in that is, there was a time when the way to approach people was by telling them what to believe. We don't live in a culture like that. We live in a culture that still wants to believe, but wants to self-discover that belief. So you must attach a means under that end that creates discovery, in which each person says, theoretically, oh. So you have to set them up for it logically, but not pull the trigger.
We have two more questions out there. John Grassmick told me to wrap it up by 11:15, and that clock says 11:16. So I'm going to go to a higher authority. Mark Bailey, is it okay if we take these two questions? Okay.
Would you like to be the ogre, Mark?
he said yes. Okay, so we're going to take these two, and then those have to be our last ones.
Okay. Hello. I'm glad that my question will be answered at least, though. The question is, does a person have to believe in the deity of Christ and in the true triune God in order to be saved?
Scott?
He has to believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God who died in his place. Now, whether he understands Trinity as a whole, that already implies Father. I would say to be saved, I'm not sure. That Jesus Christ is the Son of God who died for him to reconcile him with the Father, yes. For the full doctrine of the Trinity, I want to say yes, but I think God's mercy may be greater than that. If he's denying the Trinity, then no.
But if one does not understand the doctrine of the Trinity, simply it's unclear, then I believe the Spirit is attracting him toward the truth. But I think we better be careful in saying, without articulation or cognitive understanding of the doctrine of the Trinity, one cannot be saved.
It's the difference between ignorance and heresy, that there's nothing wrong with being unaware and being ignorant of the Trinity, but denial of the Trinity would be heretical.
Because who of us understood the Trinity when we came to Christ?
And related to that, we could certainly argue that it's absolutely consistent and inherent to the gospel that we understand, or that Jesus is both fully God and fully human. It's inherent to the gospel that the Trinity be true as the Spirit indwells us in regeneration. At the same time, those are layers that continue to extend out from the centered set rather than bounded set language of your question, that the center core of the gospel is that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, was raised from the dead according to the Scriptures, and that he offers eternal life to those who believe in him. And as we further articulate that, we add multiple layers that ultimately are expressed in all the language of the ecumenical creeds and everything else, but we don't set that up as a bounded set for someone at the point of salvation and say, you've got to understand and articulate all of this, even though you're only 4 years old and we're sitting here right in my kitchen. You know, so what these guys are saying, I think, is correct, but I would add to it that the language of bounded set on that particular question may well get you in trouble. That may prove to be to lead you to some contradictions in what you believe to be inherent to the message, in what you believe to be necessary in the message. And I think we can avoid that by asking it slightly differently about what is central, and then how does it build and layer on top. One last question.
Sure, and I'll try to be brief, given the time. Edwards worked under a certain level of presuppositions with his audience. He could demand a lot from them because there was a great level of scriptural understanding. I mean, and that's apparent when you read his sermons. We don't live in that time anymore. And my question then is, if we are going to stand on the traditions of Edwards and the other great revivalists of our time, of the church history, first, what in the church is in need of reviving? And second, what should be our singular message to address it?
John, can you lead us that way?
Well, I can say this. Edwards, when you read his sermons, you realize that this guy knew his audience and knew when his audience changed. If you read his sermons to his parishioners, you get pretty heavy stuff. When you read his sermons to the Indians when he was a missionary out in Stockbridge, you're just amazed that how this man spoke the language of diverse groups of people. So, I don't mean literal languages. I mean very simple, almost Acts 17 stuff when he's among the Indians. God, the great creator, he's going to announce him to you. So I think Edwards is a wonderful example of a person who knew his audiences well. When you read his works, like Faithful Narrative, he really knew the parishioners one-on-one and all that. I guess ultimately, I'm not capable of finally answering the question because, I mean, what is not negotiable is the Lord Jesus Christ. We will not negotiate him. We will not negotiate him as the divine incarnate redeemer who came to make purchase upon Calvary's tree for sinners. If that is not our central message, we don't have a message that's distinctive.
And resurrection, we could fill it in. That's the core. Now, how to color between the lines. What else other you do, it seems to me, is a function of insight, wisdom, and stupidity.
I don't think we need revival nearly as much as we need regeneration. And by regeneration, I mean what Jesus meant in Matthew. What we need is recreation. And we are eschatological people with an eschatological hope. And what we need is to communicate to a plurality of cultures in a plurality of situations the message of the person and work of Christ in his first and second coming, and that when he returns and recreates the heaven and earth, things then will be the way they are supposed to be. That message is transcendent. If pushed, I will even say timeless. And that really is the heart of the gospel, and it's the heart of what we do. And that obviously we don't start at the same place in every situation, that Edwards didn't start at the same place in Northampton as he did in Enfield, as he did with the Indians. But ultimately, the message we proclaim is a message of hope. It's a message that when God's work of redemption is completed, we will live together with him in a city with no sorrow, nor shame, and this where the curse of sin is forever removed. And that message changes lives. That message changes the world. That is our contribution to a dead world.
What I hear Glenn saying repeatedly this morning, and what I hear these other colleagues of mine saying as well, is that good theology matters, not just because you get it right, but because it gives hope to people who really desperately need it. So we didn't pray our way into this, but we will pray our way out. Would you pray with me? Our Father, we thank you for the delight, for the play of theology, that we can banter about these things, yet at the same time we take them with a desperate seriousness, knowing that this is our interaction with the truth of God. Help us to enjoy studying, talking about your truth. Help us to enjoy the people to whom we minister. And help us to see how your word, your truth, can bring hope to them and to us. Lift our eyes that we may see the glory of our Savior, that we may enjoy him and even one another on this day. In Jesus' name, amen.